Welcome to our daily devotion. The Methodist Church of Barbados invites you to sing, pray, and worship with us as we declare God's glory and celebrate His mighty acts.
Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting Father, as we come together in this act of devotions this evening, we pray that your Holy Spirit will be with us. We pray that your Holy Spirit will minister to our hearts as we turn the pages of Scripture. Enlighten us, dear Heavenly Father. And if there be any way that you find within us that doesn't accord to your word, remove it from us. Allow us, dear Heavenly Father, in this moment to have the opportunity to come apart from the world and just spend a few moments with you, dear Heavenly Father. We thank you for all the blessings that you have bestowed upon each and every one of us. We thank you, dear Heavenly Father, that you continue to show up in our lives, that you, dear Heavenly Father, are a God who cares about us, a God who ministers to us at our various points of need. We thank you, dear Heavenly Father, for all the provision that you have made for us. We thank you for all the ways that you are protecting us from the evil one, dear God. We thank you, dear Heavenly Father, for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died on a cross so that each and every one of us could be saved. Almighty and everlasting Father, we know that we haven't always followed your word. We haven't always followed the things, dear God, that you have required of us. We have fallen into sin on many occasions. We pray, dear Heavenly Father, that you will forgive us of all of our sins, dear God, that you will wipe them away from us as far as east is west. And so, dear Heavenly Father, as we come apart, we pray that your Holy Spirit will guide us, that you will minister to us in the singing of hymns and songs, on the reading of Scripture, and on meditating upon your word. Dear God, we just commit this entire act of worship, this devotions into your hands, and pray that your will be done through no other name than the wonderful name of our risen Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Sing tune my heart to sing thy grace, streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet sung by flaming tongues above, praise the mountain fixed upon it, Mount of thy redeeming love. Hitherto constrained to be. Let thy goodness, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts
above. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 10 to 18. Now I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you be in agreement, that there be no divisions among you, but that you be knitted together in the same mind and the same purpose. For it has been made clear to me by Cleo's people that there are quarrels among you, my brothers and sisters. What I mean is that each of you says, I belong to Paul, or I belong to Apollos, or I belong to Cephas, or I belong to Christ. Has Christ been divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Or were you baptized in the name of Paul? I thank God that I baptized none of you except Crispus and Gaius, so that no one can say that you were baptized in my name. I did baptize also the household of Stephanas. Beyond that, I do not know whether I baptize anyone else, for Christ did not send me to baptize, but to proclaim the gospel, and not with eloquent wisdom, so that the cross of Christ might not be emptied of its power. For the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. Let us go to God in prayer. Loving God, we again come together this night to celebrate you, to give you thanks and praise for all that you've done for us, to fellowship with each other as we sing your praises and to meditate on your word. So we invite you now, Spirit of the Living God, to minister to us as we join together as a body of believers to study your word, to hear a word in season from you. So Holy Spirit, come and be our interpreter. Reveal your word to us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Brothers and sisters, tonight I want us to reflect on Paul's letter to the believers at Corinth, chapter 1, where he made an appeal to them to live in harmony with each other as children of God. And he also expressed to them the authority through which he was able to address them and address the state or condition that they were living under in the church. Corinth was one of the churches established by Paul during his missionary journeys, where he traveled and visited various places to spread the good news of Jesus Christ. We know that Paul was deliberate in maintaining his connection and communication with the believers at the 14 churches he had established across the regions, and he visited them where possible or sent written correspondence to the leaders of every congregation. Paul was constantly in communication with the believers, and he did not allow the limited means for travel and communication to hinder his responsibilities and duties as pastor or spiritual leader of the various congregations. Unlike the period of Paul's ministry, we today as pastors, class leaders, church school teachers, members of various fellowships or ministries have access to several mediums or platforms through which we can communicate with our members, as well as the means of transportation that we have that we can move around and visit or with our members as well. And like Paul, therefore, we must be intentional in our communication and fellowship with each other in all circumstances across our region. When Paul wrote this correspondence to the believers at Corinth, he was on his third missionary visit in Ephesus. However, Paul was familiar with the congregation at Corinth, having spent about 18 months with them while on his second missionary journey there. Paul knew of the problems that were present in the church. He knew of the situations that led to a culture of division or disharmony. And as a result, he immediately asks for unity and harmony. He asks that they work together as members of a team, not forming any alliances among each other. What Paul was saying, that as one body, they should have Jesus Christ, his call on their lives and his mission as their only focus, and that believers should work together for Christ to conduct his kingdom business at all times. In this letter, he addressed the conditions facing the congregation, and Paul established his authority to do so by declaring that he was called to be an apostle of Jesus Christ through the will of God. Paul was a special ambassador of Jesus Christ, and through the will of God, he was qualified, therefore, to address the conditions which were being experienced by the believers at Corinth. In fact, Paul in chapter 15 of 1 Corinthians also alluded to his call and authority when he stated in verse 10, "But whatever I am now, it is all because God poured out his special favor on me." His special favor. "And not without results, for I have worked harder than any of the other apostles, yet it was not I, but God who was working through me by his grace." Paul was stating here that he received a special favor from God, a special call on his life, and that he went about that call with fervor. He went about that call with commitment. And as a result, he said here in the text that because of his hard work, he worked harder than any of the other apostles. And I believe here that he's not just comparing himself, but Paul was committed and intentional in his call. He had the zeal to do God's will. And he recognized it was not him who was at work, but God who was working through him by his grace. Paul, therefore, was able to advise the believers as it related to harmony and unity, that they are to let no divisions, or let there be no divisions in the church, but rather be of one mind, united in thought and purpose. Live together as one is a simple way that we as believers in the Lord Jesus Christ can live in harmony and avoid any division in our congregations. Paul recognized then that he was given a special calling from God to be an apostle, to preach about Jesus Christ. And we know from Scripture how God called Paul into his service, and that he went about his call with zeal, with commitment and discipline, despite the hardships, despite the persecutions he faced, despite the long, arduous journeys he had to take, and the many other challenges he experienced in his service and ministry. Like Paul, we have been called by God to several ministries, and we are equipped, we are given the gifts that are required to do the business of the kingdom, God's assigned work for us. I therefore want to urge everyone tuned into this devotion, or those who will listen to it later, to become spiritually employed. Know and use your gifts in service to God so that he can use you like he did through Paul to build up his kingdom. We too are all aware that the Church of Jesus Christ need laborers. All who are called by God, every believer, must take up our tools, get to know and recognize our gifts so that we will be ready and equipped for kingdom business. Let us pray to the Lord of the harvest to send laborers. Let us pray for an outpouring of the Holy Spirit and the gifts of the Spirit upon every member of our congregation. As believers, we all need to identify our gifts and calling. And to do this, we need the Holy Spirit to reveal our gifts. We need the Holy Spirit to reveal to us the call that he has on our lives. We need the Holy Spirit to reveal to us our purpose here in the kingdom. It is the Holy Spirit who gives and reveals our gifts. It is the Holy Spirit who gives and reveals our purpose and call. And we're reminded in Scripture that all we need to do as children of God, as believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, is to ask God for His Holy Spirit. Luke 11 and 13 tells us, "So if you sinful people know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask Him?" Scripture also tells us about the gifts in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 27 and following. "Now you are the body of Christ," referring to all believers, "and members individually. And God has appointed these in the church: first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, after that miracles, then gifts of healing, helps, administration, varieties of tongues." Brothers and sisters, for us to be effective in our kingdom work, it is clear that we must ask God for the outpouring and infilling of the Holy Spirit. And when we examine the coming of Jesus Christ into the world, we see that Jesus, though He was God, in His humanity, to operate as a human being, He needed the Holy Spirit. And in receiving the Holy Spirit, He was able to identify and confirm His call, and also to stand up against the temptation of the devil, and later to operate in His ministry with power and authority. We know that it was at His baptism that He received the Holy Spirit, and later He was able to outline His call and purpose when He went to the temple, where He stated in Luke chapter 4, verse 18, a familiar verse, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for He's anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim that captives will be released, that the blind will see, and that the oppressed will be set free." Jesus, in His humanity, needed the Holy Spirit. And you remember that when John the Baptist was reluctant in his baptism, he said that it must be so. Additionally, we see that the disciples, before they embarked on their work, were told to remain in Jerusalem until they received the Holy Spirit. And we know that at Pentecost, they were filled with the Holy Spirit, an event that fulfilled the prophetic word from Joel chapter 2 and verse 28, where it states, "Then after all these things, I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams, and your young men will see visions." Brothers and sisters, then this empowerment and identification of their calling came through the Holy Spirit. And the disciples, we know from Scripture, went about their ministry and call by preaching and teaching and healing with boldness, with authority, and with commitment. But just as Jesus then in His humanity needed the Holy Spirit to carry out His assigned purpose, and just as the disciples needed the Holy Spirit to empower them and equip them for service, even more, we as believers today need to be filled with the Holy Spirit in order to conduct the business of advancing the kingdom of God here in our region, here in Barbados, in our various congregations and circuits across this island. It is necessary and important that all believers identify their gifts so that we can discover what God has called us to do and be intentional in our service to God. We are reminded that it is the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, that imparts gifts. It is the Spirit of God that endows skilled craftsmen with special talents and was the source of inspiration of the prophets. If we reflect on Exodus chapter 31 and verse 3, the text tells us that then the Lord said to Moses, "Look, I have specially chosen Bezalel, son of Uri, grandson of Ur, of the tribe of Judah." And this is what jumps out at us as it relates to the Holy Spirit. He said, "I have filled him with the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, given him great wisdom, ability, and expertise in all kinds of crafts. He is a master craftsman, expert in working with gold, silver, and bronze. He is skilled in engraving and mounting gemstones and in carving wood. He is a master at every craft." Brothers and sisters, then this same Spirit of God, this same Holy Spirit that Jesus, when he left this earth, he said that he have to go, but I will leave you another comforter, a paraclete, the one who will lead and guide us into all truth. This Holy Spirit is still calling and endowing persons with gifts for service. The church has available to it. We as the believers, we have available all the resources that are needed to conduct the work God has called us to perform. We have the resources for mission and evangelism. We have the resources for our finances, that we can bring our finances across the various congregations and churches into order so that we can get on with the kingdom business. We have the resources available to us through the Holy Spirit for our Methodist schools and the initiatives that we are putting out to help young men and women in understanding and learning. Whatever we need, God has given the church everything it needs to conduct his business. So therefore, let us ask God for the anointing of his Spirit. Let us ask for the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Let us also ask for the infilling of the Holy Spirit for those who have already been baptized in the Holy Spirit daily. As we meditate on his word, as we pray, let us ask for the infilling of the Holy Spirit and the outpouring of the gifts among all believers. Let us ask. Let us pray. And God promised that when we ask for the Holy Spirit, he said he will give it to us. So Methodist family, as I close, let us this year get to know our call. Let us be able to identify our gifts that are given by God through his Holy Spirit. Let us be able to recognize and know what is God's will for our lives. And let us work together in harmony as classes, as congregations, as circuits, as districts, as we advance the kingdom business of spreading scriptural holiness throughout the lands and transforming these nations that God has placed us in to do his work. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen and amen.
Come on, let the sound of worship be released from your lips tonight. Come on, raise it now. Oh, that's good, y'all. Raise it. In a motion. Love inside. the dry bones respond. I gotta run over till cancer responds. I gotta run over till my family responds. I gotta run over. I wanna run over. I wanna run over. Fill me up till I overflow. Come on. I wanna run over. I wanna run over. Say, fill me up till I overflow. I wanna run over. I wanna run over.
Gracious God, we thank you for reminding us, first, of the importance of living in harmony with each other. Not setting up alliances or being divided, but to be on the same team as believers in the Lord Jesus Christ. Help us, Lord, to have the spirit of reconciliation in our relationships. Help us, Lord, to restore the friendships and the fellowships that were broken for whatever reason, Lord, that we can live in harmony and that we can be of one spirit as your church. Lord, I pray also, though, tonight that we would all come to you and ask for your Holy Spirit, and that you will pour out your gifts upon your church, upon every member of our church. Lord, that you will do a new thing among us, Lord, that we would recognize and know our gifts, that we will recognize and know our purpose, that we will recognize and know our call. And like Paul in the text, let us be a people who are willing to go out and work hard for the kingdom, recognizing, Lord, that it is not us, but the Spirit in us that is working through us by His grace. So thank you for your word this night. I pray even now, Lord, in the name of Jesus, that you will manifest your power, that your Holy Spirit will come upon every member hearing this devotion tonight, and even those who will listen to it on a later date, Lord, that you will pour out your Holy Spirit, that the gifts of the Spirit will be present and active in our lives. Let there be some apostles, some prophets, some teachers, some miracles, gifts of healing, gifts of help, gifts of administration, and varieties of tongues. And then that we can be equipped to advance the work of your kingdom. So we thank you and we praise you for all that you're going to do. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.
To him we pray.
Thank you for being a part of our daily devotion. We trust it has been a blessing to you. Now together, let us hold fast to His word and may it dwell in all of us richly.